So our next speaker will be Arilas.
So I will try some first words in German, but the rest of my presentation will be in English. Also, ich bin, als ich gesagt habe gestern, es ist eine riesige Ehre für mich, diese Celebration zu organisieren, aufzubauen, und ich befreue mich wirklich, dass es wirklich bekommt. Und es ist eine riesige Ehre für mich, dass Sie, Herr Professor Knobloch, nach Paris gekommen sind. Und Sie sind nicht nur mein Mentor, aber der Mentor meiner Mentoren auch. Und ich habe eine riesige Schuld in meine Forschungen und in meiner Methode und so weiter in eure Werk. So I want to talk about combinatorics and the huge work that you, Professor Knobloch, did in that topic. I will just talk about a small part of it, so the case of determinants. But I brought yesterday all the books that Edouard Knobloch published on that are really crucial edition for that field, but I forgot it in the other building, so it's not there, but it is in the other building. So to begin, I didn't translate that schema, but it's a schema that I did for my PhD thesis, which were on combinatorics in Leibniz, and the work of Everard Knobloch were the ground of my research. And I wanted to understand more correctly what is combinatorics in Leibniz, and it is a really difficult question. And a lot of what Edouard Knobloch did allows me to make real important steps in that comprehension, and I thank him a lot for that. And one of the big questions that concern the comprehension of what is combinatorics in Leibniz is this distinction that we have to make between the way that Leibniz used combinatorics to create new expressions, so new characters, what it is called ars characteristica, and the way that Leibniz use combinatorics to find new things, so ars inveniendi. And those two aspects are not exclusive at all. They are used together, but it is really important to distinguish them in order to understand the ways in the huge writing of Leibniz that those ideas developed themselves and the different work of Leibniz that they produced. The case of determinants is a real important case because it is one of the first work of Leibniz that were received by the mathematician, the philosopher, the historian as a direct application of Ars Characteristica and the universal characteristic of Leibniz. And it's directly how it shows how combinatorics can improve algebra and produce new truths that Cartesian methods were unable to produce. And that is a real important motto for Leibniz, to show that the combinatorics can promote algebra in a further way and produce new truths that the Cartesian method were unable to prove. So it was the first example, and it was seen as the main illustration of the application of that method, and the work of Eberhard Knobloch will show the diversity of the method that Leibniz developed to solve algebraic equation, the combinatorial method that Leibniz developed to solve algebraic equation, and it will allow to understand more specifically this application. So I will begin by showing the reception of this determinant of Leibniz. So Leibniz didn't publish anything. He published only two things about determinants, and his discovery were lost and discovered again more than one century later. So the two publications are those. So the first is in 1700 in Acta Eruditorum, so the German journal that Leibniz participated to found. Leibniz, so it's a response to on an account of Nicolas Fatio of Duillet, Leibniz talk about his method at the end of that article. So here, so moreover, this I should explain what is the method of Leibniz. The method of Leibniz is to represent the constant, the variable, not by a letter like Viet begins to do, but by numbers, but not numbers that are the numbers. So, for example, 2 or 3, and so on, but numbers that represent the place of the variable and the role of the variable in the equation. And that is the great idea of Leibniz. So he explained that idea in this article. So moreover, this representation has been extremely useful for new rules, which are themselves useful and widely disseminated, as much as what can be judged from the present theorem as in the future for when those great things that I hope will happen, such as the fact of constituting tables of analytic rules. And it is only in this way, through the characteristic drawn from the combinatorial part, that we will perfect the algebra that is subordinate to it. So Leibniz explained again his motto to perfect algebra. I will go further. So the second publication of that method is in the Miscellaneae Berolinciae, so the first publication of the Journal of the Academy of Science of Berlin in 1710. In that journal, there is many articles and a lot of Leibniz. But in the section of mathematics, Leibniz began as an editor, not as a contributor, by a section explaining the use of symbols, the mathematical use of symbols. So it's a section to explain that. And in that section, he mentioned his invention. Sometimes we use numbers instead of letters, but they mean the same things as the letters. They are nevertheless useful for expressing relationships. Okay, but this usage is not common and is only used very rarely. So he said that is his own discoveries, but it is not well common, and that it's not a common way to express equations. So after the first time that mention of that discovery will appear again, will be after Leibniz's death, so in 1765, when the Nouveaux Essais were first published. And so in the Nouveaux Essais, Leibniz mentioned very quickly this invention too. We see also that I could have done without letter if I had treated the number as letter. That is to say, if instead of putting 2a equal 17 and 2b equal 4, I had written 2a equal 10 plus 6, and 2b equal 10 minus 6, which would have given me a equal 1 half of 10 plus 6, 10 plus 6, and b equal 1 half of 10 minus 6. This in the particular calculation itself, I would have had the calculation general, taking these notes 10 and 6 for general numbers, as if they were letters x and v, in order to have a more general truth or method. And taking this same character 10 and 6 again for number they ordinarily denote, I will have a sensible example and which can serve even as a test. So that's the same invention using letters, numbers to represent variable, but you see that it is not used for algebraic resolution of a linear system or algebraic equation. So it denotes the fact that this invention was used for many, many applications in Leibniz. I pursue. And as Vieta substitutes letters from numbers to achieve greater generality, I wanted to reintroduce the numbers characters since they are more appropriate than letters into the specimen itself. So I pass. The first time that the word determinant were used for the way that we use now is in Gauss, in Disquisitiones Arithmeticae in 1801. The number pb minus ic on which firstly the property of the form abc fundamentally depends, as we will teach in the following, we will call that number the determinant then in Latin, of this form. The determinant appear, the word determinant appear at that time, but Gauss knows the work, the previous work of van der Monde or Cramer. Stories of Leibniz determinant begin in 1850 when Carl Emanuel Gerhardt published the works of Leibniz. So Gerhardt, as it was presented by Professor Probst yesterday. Karl Emanuel Gerhard published in that time a lot of mathematical work of Leibniz within the collection of Pertz. And the collection of Gerhard, so the sub-collection of Gerhard, were divided into two sections, one for the correspondence, so Erste Abteilung, and the second for writing, the Zweite Abteilung. So this is the second volume of the correspondence. He published first the correspondence, and then he will publish the writing. And he published a letter to L'Hôpital of March 1693. So that's not this letter, but in that letter, Leibniz talked about his invention. But he will talk again, so he talk about his invention. L'Hôpital answer, I don't understand what you are talking about. So he will explain. And then in the other letter, so this letter of April 1693, Leibniz explain what is it. So since you say that you find it's hard to believe, that it is as general as convenient to use standards as to use numbers, I don't know what it is, to use numbers as to use letters, I must not have explained myself properly. And he gives that that formula, and the quadrat, the square form, the square form of the formula show to people of that time that it is linked to determinant. So but Gerhard seems not to make any relation with determinant at that time. So in the commentary of Gerhard, there is no relation. The relation will appear in a book in 1857 by Balzer, Theorie und Anwendung der Determinant. So the first idea of helping algebra by forming combinatorial aggregates, which today are called determinants, originated with Leibniz, as Professor Dirichlet has remarked. Apart from the letter of L'Hôpital in April, in which Leibniz expresses his conviction of the truthfulness of his idea, nothing seems to be left from which it could be concluded that Leibniz endeavored to produce further fruits of this idea. So that's totally wrong. Professor Knobloch published extremely diverse work of Leibniz in which he endeavored to produce further fruits of this idea, but the book of Balzer will focus the attention of that letter to L'Hôpital. So I pass, and then in 1858. The first volume of the writing of Gerhard were published. So the volume which we call now Gerhard 5 were published before what we call now Gerhard 4, because Gerhard 5 is the first volume of the writing and Gerhard 4 is the last volume of the correspondence. And in that volume, Gerhard published the first publication of Leibniz that I presented at the beginning. And there is no reference to determinants again, but in the next volume, so Gerhard 4, the first volume of the correspondence, Gerhard make an allusion, mention the work of Balzer. So he says, as a result, Leibniz not only obtained very harmonically formed expression in elimination, in which the first foundation for the theory of determinants, which has become so important in recent time, has been recognized. Okay, so you see,
yeah, Balzer
theory. Okay, how many time do you have?
No, 10 minutes.
10 minutes, so I will go quick, more quick. Another mention of that will be done by Orly Perkin in France in the same time, so in 1860. Orly Perkin published an article on limits and determinants in the bulletin d'histoire, bulletin de bibliographie, d'histoire, biographie et de biographie mathématique, which he founded. And he referred directly to Gerhard's work. So in a letter from Leibniz to L'Hôpital, dated for Hanover, and inserted in volume 2 from Gerhard, we read, and then the article consists in a commentary of the letter to L'Hôpital. Perkin concludes, the origin, so I find that that passage interesting. The origin of determinant dates back to 1693. It is the new jewel of the immensely rich and splendid case of the author of infinitesimal hierarchy, infinitesimal calculus and characteristic. I don't know why this word here. He discovered not only Cramer's determinant, but what is even more essential, Vandermonde's characteristic. Admiration is at its height when we hear the illustrious prophet proclaim 2 centuries in advance the high position of the combinatorial characteristic in all analysis, a position that has only been revealed in our own day. And then he says, if I were asked what is the most intelligence in depth, the most universal direction that God has graced the earth since the apparition of man, I will answer without hesitation, Leibniz. Okay. The work of Balzer will be translated in French the year after the publication of Perkin. And for the end, Gerhard published the last book of the writing of Leibniz in 1863. And in that book, Gerhard mentioned the determinant again. So he explained the use of fictive numbers, so the invention of Leibniz, and he explains it. Okay. Balzer's book were published many times, edited many times. In the fourth edition, Balzer added another sources of Leibniz, because he discovered that Leibniz published it 2 times, and not once. So he added the publication of 1700 in the Acta Eruptorum. In 1891, Gerhard finally published an article in their Wittenbericht der König Bischof Preußer Akademie der Wissenschaften zu Berlin, which is called Leibniz über die Determinanten, in which Gerhard explained the origin of the invention of Leibniz. Made the relation with the work on Leibniz on equation in the latest time of Paris. Okay, I will go quickly. So just during that time, this story of the origin of determinant in the letter to L'Hôpital will have a lot of success. And in many publications, you will find that the determinant originated in that letter of 1693. So I'll give you a lot of examples. So I will pass that part, but just to say that in Coutura's work and Serre's work, who work a lot about combinatorics, the view are more subtle. So I pass to edition of Eberhard Knobler. So Eberhard Knobler published a lot of things about determinants, and in an article in the Revue d'Histoire des Sciences, he explained very pedagogically the use of fictive numbers by Leibniz, and he said, as a result, Leibniz invented more than 50 ways of using fictitious numbers. Only two were published in 1700 and 1710, so the two I showed. So the main article that Eberhard Knobler published on that topic was in 1974. It is Unbekannte Studien von Leibniz zu Eliminations- und Explikationstheorie. And in that article, Eberhard Knobler commented an unpublished manuscript, which is that one, and he published that manuscript in as an appendix of the article, and it is a really beautiful edition because it's a really hard manuscript. He explained totally new ways of applying fictive numbers by Leibniz, especially a way that Leibniz used fictitious number, used the image of genealogic trees to use fictitious numbers, and it's very beautiful. He make an explication in that very, very beautiful article in the book History of Science, History of Text, edited by Karin Schenla. Eberhard Knobler talk about the process, the way that Leibniz work on manuscripts. It's really, really beautiful, and he mentioned that manuscript too. To show that those inventions are not only inventions to produce new truth, but are also inventions to produce new methods of working on manuscripts. And that's really, really important. So in 1980, Eberhard Knobler published Der Beginn der Determinantentheorie. He split the work of Leibniz in four sections: study of linear system, general equation of higher degrees in several variables, study of elimination of a general variable from two equations of higher degree, and study of algebraic division. And he published 66 texts in which Leibniz work on those topics. So he really show the diversity of the work of Leibniz on that topic. It was not just an invention that he mentioned here or there. It was a really field of research for Leibniz, and the work of Eberhard Knobler showed that, showed that. Also, Leibniz found many important results. He never published any of them, on which is, in my opinion, the following. No result is demonstrated. All the rules and theorems are based on observation and induction. That is the conclusion of the article in Revue d'Histoire des Sciences of Eberhard Knobler. And it shows that to understand the mathematical work of Leibniz, you don't have to look at the theorems, but you have to look at the work and the work that that weren't demonstrated, that was not rigorous, and that composed a big part of mathematical practice of Leibniz. And if you published all that, you obtain a new comprehension of the rigorous theorem and rigorous things done by Leibniz. And that's what Eberhard Knobler affirmed. I end my presentation by showing some monstrous aspects of Leibniz manuscript that are in that edition of Determinants Theory, to show what Eberhard Knobloch deal with that. And so the one of the problem we are we face with Leibniz manuscript is the huge table, and Eberhard Knobloch use folded pages. There is really a complicated diagram, and so yes. And another issue is you see that the numbers are not in the same size, and the size means something in the equation, so you have to adapt it. And it's really hard to see in the manuscript when the size is important, when the size is not important. So it was also a big issue that and that not concern only determinant theory, but I found that example really fascinating. So it is a really, really hard corrected manuscript. And Eberhard Knobloch wrote in that in his edition, in the case of piece 12 and 14, the arrangement of variants necessitated the repetition of more than 10 letters. So that is the phase of correction. So there is more than 10 phase of correction. So in this case, we will write A under overline, it is overline in the edition, then instead of A 11 times, and 2A overline instead of A 12 times. So it's really really impressive that philological edition is really, really impressive. And to finish, I will thank again you, Eberhard Knobloch, for your work and your presence here. And to finish on the characteristic of Leibniz. So Leibniz said that everything can be represented by a good character. So thank you.